Naughty Boy, as well as Kyla and Pop Can. You just listened to Should Have Been Me on 88.2 Sanyu FM. It's a hit selector. I am Crystal, and I'd like to welcome my guest on Celeb Select. I'm excited. I have Nancy Kacungira here with me. Did I pronounce your name right?
Yes. Pretty much the way my grandmother would, which is absolutely the right way.
I have a feeling your name gives a lot of people a rough time.
Oh, my goodness.
Mm-hmm. What are some of the versions that have come up?
I don't want to say what they are, because when I do, people like them and then they stick.
So okay.
There have been some really bad versions. I've had people call me at the BBC and say, okay, how do I say this? So now I have to write it,
mm-hmm.
you know, like chew, like C-H-U-W.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so people can actually it say it right.
Yes.
But well, welcome to Celeb Select.
Thank you so much for having me.
It's nice to have you home in Uganda as well.
Yes, mm-hmm. always good.
It seems first like a pretty hectic trip, this one, though.
It is. It's quite busy. Doing a lot of things, mm-hmm. Chiefly... I'm here for the BBC, actually.
Mm-hmm.
Just doing a few talks about journalism with students, young journalists.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, hopefully trying to get them interested in this beautiful industry. In this industry, exactly. In this job. I'll call it a calling,
mm-hmm.
and a passion.
Yes.
And yes, and also hopefully getting some of them to apply for this year's Komla Dumor Award.
Okay, yeah. Okay. Well, we always start right at the beginning of this show. We want to know where you were born, where you went to school, a little bit about your parents.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
I was born in Arusha, mm-hmm. in Tanzania. And I went to school in Tanzania, mm-hmm. for the first 7 or so years of my life. So my father was, still is, a pilot. And that's where he worked, with the Mission Aviation Fellowship,
mm-hmm.
in Tanzania.
Mm-hmm.
Dodoma is where I spent most of my childhood. It still is a really, really small town. I mean,
mm-hmm.
you know, if we had 3 cars, we'd say, oh, there's a traffic jam.
What? Are you serious?
No, it was such a tiny, 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 sleepy town.
Mm-hmm.
Even when I go back there, it's like nothing's changed.
Okay.
So, yeah, very small. I went to a missionary school.
Mm-hmm.
So most of the students in my class were sons and daughters of missionaries there.
Okay.
So a lot of Australians and Americans and... Yeah, so it was a different system.
Mm-hmm.
It was actually shocking for me when I came to Uganda. Because
after those 7 years you came here?
After those 7 years I came to Uganda.
Mm-hmm.
And it was a shock, because when my parents told me you're going to boarding school in Uganda, I was like, yay, Mallory Towers. You know, I'd read the book by Enid Blyton and I thought, we're going to ride horses and eat sausages for breakfast. Mm-hmm. This is fantastic.
Uh-huh. And then?
Wow. And I was introduced to the joys of porridge. with lumps in it as big as your fist.
Mm-hmm.
And just, it was not what I expected. But apart from that, it was really difficult, because the school I was in before was an entirely different system. I mean, mm-hmm. it was so... We didn't even have exams.
You didn't have exams?
We didn't have exams. At the end of the term, mm-hmm. you'd get a report card and it would say, Nancy is a very intuitive child who enjoys music and is caring to others.
So it was more just of an assessment.
Yeah, it was more about your character,
mm-hmm.
and your, you know, your particular strengths and skills, and your, which was really good. It was nice to have.
Mm-hmm.
It just didn't equip me very well for the
system here.
Yeah. I remember thinking, what on earth are bases? And this is my senior one,
uh-huh.
entrance exam.
Oh my.
It's like, what on earth is a base? I don't know what that is, because mm-hmm. we'd learned very different things.
Mm-hmm.
So it was difficult in the beginning.
Mm-hmm.
And I had this accent nobody could understand. So it was frustrating and difficult.
Mm.
But I learned to fit in. I was in Namasagali. That's where I went first.
Yes.
Which I guess is maybe a softer landing than some other places could have been.
I think so. I actually think so. I mean, it was a lot more flexible and
yes.
unique, I'll say.
Yes, I think it was. So, so I started to fit in, started to work my way around the system. And I think I was actually at the top of the class at the end of the term.
What?
Like that. Yes.
Oh, look at you.
Look at me. Where did all that brilliance go? Anyway, so yes, it was a lot of tough knocks, mm-hmm. but I'm really glad for those years of boarding school. I think they toughened me up.
Mm-hmm.
I was, quite a sheltered child up mm-hmm. until that point.
Mm-hmm.
But it was good to sort of branch out and see a different side of the world.
Okay. Yeah. Do you feel you also found a foundation? You built a foundation at home in Uganda then?
Absolutely. For some reason, Uganda just felt like home. And even after school,
mm-hmm.
I didn't go back to Tanzania. I felt like this is where I want
to
stay.
Did you have the choice to go back?
I did. Mm-hmm. I did. Up until I was 18, I had the choice of whether I was Tanzanian or Ugandan because I was born in Tanzania.
Mm-hmm.
But somehow, I don't know what it is, but Uganda just feels right.
You fell in love.
I fell in love.
With
yes,
Uganda.
Yes.
Okay.
Also just, yeah, it feels like where I belong.
Okay, so after Namasagali College, where did you go?
After Namasagali College, I went to A-level in Chibuli
mm-hmm.
Secondary School.
Mm-hmm.
And it's actually a really bad and really funny story how I got there.
Oh, okay.
It was a dare.
It was?
Yes.
A dare.
Uh-huh. So I had this really crazy friend and we dared each other to put as our first choices schools that we would never, ever go to.
Are you serious?
I am very serious.
Oh, my.
So I did this because I thought to myself, it's okay. I know I'm going to go to my second choice, which is going to be St. Lawrence. So it doesn't really matter what I put as my first.
Mm-hmm.
So I was like, fine, we dared each other. And she put Kawempe Muslim
mm-hmm.
because we'd heard these are schools where you really get beaten. Yeah. So.
Okay.
I know. Don't judge us. We were young.
Mm-hmm.
So, yes. And I put my first choice as Chibuli Secondary School and my results came back and I'd got in.
Yay!
And my dad was ecstatic and I was crying. And he was saying,
like, I didn't
isn't
plan
this what
this
you wanted?
Quite this way.
Yes.
Okay.
But as in all of life, sometimes the things you think are not what's good for you are actually very good for you.
Mm-hmm.
And Chibuli was actually a really good experience.
Mm-hmm.
It was great for me. I became head girl there in my senior six. And Overall, I really enjoyed my time there. So it worked out.
Okay. Now, most people know you as the journalist.
Yes.
But you also have a passion for the arts. And speaking of Namasagali College, I mean,
yes.
you were a dancer.
Yes.
And you were in a lot of the productions as well.
That's true. I still dance, actually,
mm-hmm.
Once in a while. But and it's funny, until I went to Namasagali, I had no idea that I could dance.
Oh,
yeah,
okay.
No idea. But then my sister suggested I go for a class, and I did. And they just said to everyone, okay, now try and do a 180 degree split. And I was like, okay, I can try that. And I did it. And I was like, oh, okay.
Mm-hmm.
Apparently, I can do this stuff.
Learning on the job.
Learning on the job. And I never looked back. So I fell in love with dancing, and it's been a passion. I did dance a bit at Watoto Church,
mm-hmm.
Where I went for a long time.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, it's something that's stayed with me over the years.
When you say that you still dance now, do you mm-hmm. like practice regularly? Do you have a dance studio that you go to sometimes?
I wish I did. Most mm-hmm. of the time it's a Saturday morning in my living room. I clear some space. But once in a while when I can, I do visit a studio or take a class,
mm-hmm.
Or, you know, just at least visit other people's shows,
mm-hmm.
just to stay in touch with that side of things.
Okay. Yeah. Well, I will ask you right now for the first song you have chosen as one of your requests.
Okay.
So we get to know the kind of music you like.
So all these years, this was all I had to do to get four requests on this show. It's come
four
on
requests.
As a guest.
Yes.
I'd have come sooner if I'd known. Okay. My first one would be Castle on the Hill.
Okay.
Ed Sheeran.
Mm-hmm.
Just because there's a lot of nostalgia in this song for mm-hmm. some reason, I think, when I listen to it.
When you say that, I mean, it sounds like there's a story there.
Not really. It's. Mm-hmm. I think it just makes me think of my childhood and,
mm-hmm.
and, you know, where I've come from and that sort of thing. It's just a nice feel good song, I think.
Okay. Yeah. All right. So here it is, Ed Sheeran, Castle on the Hill.
When I was 6 years old, I broke my leg. I was running from my brother and his friends.
The Sanyu Hit Selector.
Oh, yes, indeed. It is the hit selector. And I'm chatting with Nancy Kacungira right now on Celeb Select. Now, you were saying you ended up in your high school for A-levels based on a dare, which is crazy, absolutely crazy. Now, when you were done with your A-levels, you went to Makerere University.
Yes,
I did. What did you do at Makerere?
I did industrial and fine art.
Okay.
I majored in watercolor painting and portraiture.
Do you still paint?
I do on occasion.
So when can we see some of your work?
Well, I can tweet you some of it.
I'd love to see that. I would love to see that.
I can do that, yeah.
So you can dance, you can paint. We know you're a brilliant journalist.
Oh, thank you.
But before we got to that, so you did Makerere University, you did your 3 years.
Yes. So again, it's one of those things where you think maybe it's a terrible thing that happened to you, because I really wanted to do mass communication.
Mm-hmm.
But I missed it that year, I think 0.2 points or something like that.
Ooh,
and I thought, this is so unfair. And so I was given my second choice, which was industrial and fine art, which I ended up actually loving once again.
Mm-hmm.
So something I thought wasn't very good turned out to be a blessing in disguise.
Mm-hmm.
I really did enjoy it. I was able to work at the same time I did my degree. So I was working at Power FM as a radio presenter, and I was also working as a graphic designer on NASA Road.
Whoa.
Yes.
Okay.
The hustle is real.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So I was pretty busy. Yeah, people say, oh, I look back on my campus days. Oh, they were so crazy and fun. All I see is long nights of work and not much fun at all. So yes, it was a
busy time for you.
Pretty exhausting, yes.
Well, that just kind of means maybe you like to be busy as well. Are you one of those people, when you have nothing to do, you get anxious?
Yes, absolutely.
Mm-hmm.
It drives me crazy, I guess, to not be juggling 15 things at once. Even though I really like to complain about having 15 things to juggle.
Mm-hmm.
But I guess, yes, perhaps I do like to stay busy, because I always find myself in that situation.
Okay.
So, yes. So I went to Makerere and did art. I was able to graduate with a first class degree, which was fantastic.
Yes.
And I kept working at Power FM after that, and continuing to do my graphic design as a freelancer.
Okay. Yeah. Do you miss radio?
Not in the way that I used to do it, because I used to be a presenter.
Mm-hmm.
It was fun.
Which is very
It is different. Mm-hmm. It is different from news. It was fun, but I don't think it was really me.
Mm-hmm.
Not in the way that, you know, I think you're, you know, so flawless at it. For me, it was more something I learnt and, you know, and you really had to sort of pick up.
Okay.
Yeah. So it was fun, but I don't think it was the most natural fit for me.
Okay. A lot of people would say that you come across as very reserved.
Mm-hmm.
Would you say that you are a reserved person?
Yes, I'm actually shy, believe it or not. Well, maybe not shy, but I am an introvert.
Okay.
And I think that it's actually one of those things that you struggle with for a little bit, because you think, how can I be a journalist and an introvert?
Mm-hmm.
And it's because of these stereotypes that we have, where we think that if you are going to be a certain type of thing, then you must have a certain type of character.
Mm-hmm.
But I think learning what strengths your particular personality gives you is also important, because I learned that because I'm an introvert, I like to spend time with people. I don't particularly like crowds, but I like one-on-ones, and that's very useful when I'm building rapport with sources. They feel that they can trust me.
Mm-hmm.
I build very good relationships with contacts and sources, and that's useful as a journalist.
Mm-hmm.
So I've learned to look at it as a strength and not something that holds me back.
Okay, so how many years were you with Power FM?
I was at Power FM for donkey's years, from 2003 to about 2008, which is when I went to Leeds.
So that's about five years.
Okay. Yes.
And then you left for your master's?
And then I left for my master's. I went to Leeds in the United Kingdom, and I did a master's in international communications for a year.
Mm-hmm.
And then I came back to Uganda.
And
started a business with my sister.
Now, we've heard you say your sister, and of course you know that to us here at Zanu FM, she is
The family. Shanice.
The Shanice.
She's family.
Yes.
And you guys are very, very close.
Yes, we are.
Some people ask, okay, who's older?
It's a bit unhealthy.
Okay.
How close we are.
No. Sisters. I'm close with my siblings as well. Yes, so, yes. Who's older?
She's older.
Yeah. Okay.
Only right. 2 years, though.
Okay, two years. Mm. So, I mean, she's also been in journalism. Mm. Were you ever inspired by your big sister?
I think...
To follow, like, in her path, or...
Absolutely. I think what my sister did and has always done for me, really... is to get me out of my comfort zone. Mm-hmm. And I honestly don't know if I ever would have thought about doing radio if she hadn't.
Mm-hmm.
And because the only reason I ended up on Power FM was someone asked me to do a voiceover for an ad because I was Shanice's sister, and they maybe figured that I might have a not so bad voice. And then after that, they said, oh, your voice is actually not bad. Maybe you should try radio. And, mm-hmm. and so I did. Oh. So again, I think like many things in my life, she's the one who pushes me to get out of my shell, get out of my comfort zone and try different things. Mm. So definitely she had some influence there.
Okay, yeah. Okay. And then you started a business. So many people want to start businesses, but it's hard to have a successful one that grows over the years. Mm. Was it a decision that you sat down and deliberated for a long time, or you're like, okay, let's just do this?
Well, it's always been, I think, in our blood, if I can say that, because even when we were in our P7 vacation, we had a business.
You did?
Yes, we did.
Uh-huh.
It was crazy and probably illegal, but...
We want to hear what were you doing.
No, not illegal, but a bit naughty, because we were teaching dance to... We started out in schools, and then we went to gyms, but we were not qualified in any way other than... We think we know
Did
how
you just
to
say this was in your P7 vacation?
Yes, it was.
Oh, wow.
So I still wonder how we pulled that off and how anyone took us seriously.
Do you remember how much you were charging then?
I can't. All I remember is for our first class, we really wanted to make a good impression. So we bought mineral water and eclairs for everyone.
Mm-hmm.
That's all I remember. I can't remember how much we charged. But we did make some horrible yellow T-shirts. I think our... company was called Crazy for Dance.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, we've always sort of had that bent, and perhaps our dad was responsible for that in some way.
Okay.
Because he always involved us in business decisions that he made or ideas that he had.
Really?
Yes, he did.
How did that
as
work?
Young as we were, he would just say things like, so this is what I'm planning to do. What do you girls think?
Mm-hmm.
And we were like, you know, 7 or 8, but you know, I think it gave us this idea that this is possible for us to do, and we can continue in that path. So
okay, that's fascinating.
It is actually, now that I think about it, it's quite unusual,
because it gives you an understanding of finances from an early age, which is an advantage that many people don't have.
Yes, but I think even more than that, it just gives you the permission to think to yourself that this can be part of who I am.
Mm-hmm.
And I think a lot of us are scared of things like entrepreneurship because they look so scary and so, you know, difficult.
Mm-hmm.
But for us, it was just, this is what we do. This is what people do. They wake up and they start businesses because we'd seen our father do that and involve us.
Mm.
So I think it's always been a part of something that we felt we would do eventually.
Okay. Yeah. Well, I'm going to ask you now for your second request.
Right. My second request is an African song.
Mm-hmm.
And this one is from Nyashinski, who comes from my adopted home of Kenya, which is where I've been for the last few years.
Mm-hmm.
And I think I like this because he's trying something different. It's a different style. And yeah, he's one of the Kenyan artists who I think have jumped out at me. So
okay.
I hope you enjoy this one.
Okay, now you know from Nyashinski.
Ana degree au ni journalist, tu journalist. Nasikia wakiuliza ule boy wetu alienda wapi, amepotea kazi ile mbegu watu walipanda na kanyari.
I love this station.
88.2 Sanyu FM. Today's best music. The Sanyu Hit Selector.
Now, you were telling us about, you know, your father involved you a lot in some of the business decisions that he made as you were growing up. So when you started a business, it was quite easy for you to get the courage and get started. So what was your first step? Did you know exactly where your business was heading, or you just had an idea? I mean, how did that come together? Because it was pretty unique, your business model, I think.
Well, in hindsight, we had more guts than brains to start out with. Mm-hmm. And it was really just the, you know, just the courage, I think, that we had in spades, but maybe not so much the experience or the insight. Mm-hmm. So our first business was full of learning, absolutely chock full of learning, because we entered an industry that we didn't have direct experience in. It was a hair salon and a spa. Mm-hmm. And, you know, it was born of the fact that we thought this was a good idea.
Mm-hmm. That was Suka.
Yes, that was Suka. Mm-hmm. So it went well for a bit. But then we realized it was really draining. It was really challenging to manage. It was really difficult. And round about the same time, our mom got ill, mm-hmm. and we needed to pay our hospital bills. So there was a time when we had rent to pay. This is for Suka, the salon. We had rent to pay. Things were really tough. You know, we're taking our salaries out and putting in the business. And then we just said to ourselves, you know what, today we're going to pray and have faith that we're going to go to the salon and we'll have done so well. We'll just have made so much money and our problems will be over. Yes, yes.
Yes.
And then we get there and we open the book with anticipation and faith. And it says, tweezing, 2000. And that's all we'd done.
For the whole day.
For the whole day.
Oh, man.
So we just literally sat there and laughed because, you know, it was just, it's so overwhelming. Sometimes you just laugh. Mm-hmm. So, yeah. So even now, when you know, but we got past that and we learned from that. And you always learn more from failure than you do from success, I think. Mm-hmm. So we're always really grateful for that experience. And so now, yeah, when things get tough, we just look at each other and say, tweezing 2000.
Tweezing 2000.
And we laugh.
I like that. I like
that. Like we can get past anything.
No. From what you've said, it seems like you are someone who's just kind of open to different experiences. You're like, okay, I'm going to go to this school, see what happens. Mm. I'm going to try this out, see what happens. Mm. Is that an attitude that you carry forward in everything you do?
It doesn't come naturally. Mm. Naturally, I'm a bit of a spreadsheet person. I like to know, you know, how many toothbrushes do I have left in my stock? Mm-hmm. And, you know, just have a plan for everything and be in control. Mm-hmm. But I think trusting God is not the kind of thing that goes very well with spreadsheets and all the time. Mm-hmm. But that's something I've been learning over the years, is that when I trust God, better things than I could ever plan for actually happen in my life. And I think that's the trajectory.
Okay. So
it's only now that I'm learning to actually let go. Mm-hmm. But before, it was kicking and screaming.
Okay. Yes. All right. Okay. Yeah. Now, you've talked about, you know, starting your business, working on radio. But, I mean, there was a transition to TV. One day we're like, oh, Nancy.
When did this happen?
How did that happen?
Mm-hmm. It's a pretty random story. But I really just got a phone call from HR at NTV, who said they were looking for presenters, and someone had given them my number because they'd heard me on Power FM and they thought maybe I could make a good presenter. Mm-hmm. And so they asked me to come in for a screen test. And I thought about it. I'd never ever thought about doing TV. I thought, but TV is for perfect people. I'm not perfect. I'm just, you know, I mean, I had braces on at the time. I was like, this is never gonna work. So I did the screen test, but very half-heartedly. Mm-hmm. And then I didn't hear back for about a year. This was before I went to Leeds.
Oh.
Yes.
Okay.
So the story is actually longer, but I didn't hear back. So I went to Leeds and then I came back and then they contacted me again. And so that time I did go do the screen test and I was hired as a presenter. As a news anchor.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
And they told me I would do some training for a while, start with the lunchtime bulletins. And I was like, great, that's awesome. A week later, they sprang it on me and said, you're debuting at 9 p.m. With Uganda at 50 celebrations. Mm-hmm. And I thought, shoot me now.
But I mean, honestly, I think I did watch you your very first day.
Oh, please, and it's like, don't you've remind
been,
me.
No, but it's like you've been doing it like forever.
Oh, beneath that, I was panicked. But I guess, yeah, in hindsight, of course, now I look at it and think, what was I doing? Mm-hmm. But one thing I am perhaps grateful for then is that attitude that I always have, that I have nothing to lose. And I think it comes from being grounded in a relationship with God or whatever it is for you. It's just having a sense of self that is not pegged to your performance, mm-hmm. which is really helpful and really useful, because I think it just helps you be a little calmer about things that are nerve-wracking.
Okay. Yeah. So you started working on NTV mm-hmm. as a news anchor.
Yes.
Did your life change? Did you feel anything significant? That for when that switch happened in your life, because once you're on TV, you're walking down the street and people are like, "Hello, we watch you on TV."
Not so much actually. Maybe again because I'm such a recluse.
Where are we going to find you?
Where are you going to find me? Uh-huh. So I didn't feel like there was that much of a change. Maybe a few more tweets, but also I think it was useful in terms of learning. To deal with people's opinions of you, because not everybody is gonna have nice things to say about you.
That is true. Mm-hmm.
And there were some people who didn't have nice things to say. Mm-hmm. So it was a good lesson in terms of, I think, a good foundation in terms of how do you deal with that, and how do you deal with, because this is a very public, a very public sort of job, and you have to on a daily basis probably deal with people's opinions of you.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. So did you find, because you did international communications when you did your master's, did you find that helpful, as in diving directly into journalism, which is slightly different, like you said, from being a presenter to a news anchor?
Yes.
Did that help?
It did. In a strange way, I think all my different experiences are very useful as a journalist, because my experience in creating a business and trying to build a business, in art, that helps with the creativity when I package stories together. So in a strange way, I found that it's all really helped. And I think it's made my approach what it is. And I guess the sum of every individual is what makes them unique or special or stand out, and too often we're trying to fit in when really we should be just embracing who we are and standing out. And I think it's only when I said, you know what, I'm not gonna try and be so and so or someone else, or try and do it like someone else, I'm just gonna do it like me. If they don't like it, too bad. If they do, then great, I won't have to try so hard.
Okay. Yeah. Well, I'm going to ask you now for your third song, your third request.
Okay. This is a Ugandan one from down home. I really like this song. I think it's just special. It's from Nava and Terede. It's one of my favorite local songs.
I love the song too. Okay, here it is.
Sechemani ndi wamunawe una moyo gwenina teguchano nyayo mulala gwenange banteredde
So you told us about how you got a phone call, you did a screen test, and a year later,
yes,
you were called back to NTV.
Yeah.
How long were you with NTV before another big event in your life happened?
Only a year, actually.
A year.
Yes. So I was with NTV 2012 to 2013. And then in 2013, I got another phone call, this time from KTN. And they said, we want you to come to Nairobi. And so I thought about it and said, well, why not?
There it is again.
There it is again.
Okay, let me try.
Exactly. Let me try. See where this goes. And so I went to Nairobi, which was daunting because this is, you're doing local news for a country which, you don't have real experience or context in. So I was playing serious catch up. I mean, these are, everyone else in the newsroom has grown up there. They know who every MP is without having to, look at their notes, and so it was quite daunting for me because I had to seriously do a lot of catch up.
Yeah. Okay.
So taxi drivers, very, very useful, founts of information.
Really?
Yes.
Oh, I like the sound of that.
Yes, they helped me a lot. I found out a lot of stuff from taxi drivers.
Taxi drivers.
Yeah, because when you read newspapers and, there's a story behind the story that you don't really get from the library or Wikipedia. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so they are a really good source of that.
Okay. So you moved to KTN. There was a big change in your life. You moved to Kenya.
Yes.
But before you did, I believe you were engaged, or you got engaged just before that.
Yes, I did. Around 2012, I got engaged. Well, according to some papers, I also got married.
Oh, I remember. It was supposed to be a tycoon, wasn't it?
Yes, a tycoon of some sort. I mean, thank you for your prophecy, but...
it's yet to happen.
Yes. Mm-hmm. But that didn't pan out eventually.
Okay.
Yes, so...
Sorry about that. Was it because your careers took you in different directions?
No, I think it was just when you sit down, and it was around the time that my mother passed on. Mm-hmm. And I guess at that point, there was too much going on for me. It just didn't feel like, you know, you don't really feel like having a wedding after your mom has passed on.
Yes, yes.
So, and I think after that, it just, you know, gave a lot of pause and a lot of reflection. And, you know, just came to agreement, this was probably maybe not the right time.
Mm-hmm.
And so, yeah, we called off the wedding. I always say, you know, rather call off an engagement than a marriage. So
that is true. That is true.
Yeah.
Some people are too scared of what everyone else is going to say.
True.
So they'll just go ahead with it.
And it's such a trap. I mean, I always say, you know, the fear of other people's opinions is one of the biggest things that holds us back. And it the Bible calls it a trap. And I think the thing about a trap is you don't know that it's there.
Mm-hmm.
So a lot of our decisions we make, but subconsciously, it's because of what we think other people will say or how they will perceive us. Mm-hmm. But true freedom comes when you're free from that, when you don't think too much about what other people will say. And a few people who matter in your life, you know, their opinions can have bearing on your decisions.
Mm-hmm.
But the rest, as they say in Swahili, watasema watalala, they will say, they will speak, and at night they will go to sleep.
Okay, okay. You were recently quoted, I think a day or two ago, mm-hmm. as saying... you said that most battles are fought and won in your mind.
Yes, yes, mm-hmm. yes. I think one of the biggest lessons that has helped me in my life and my career has been learning the simple thing that I am in control of my thoughts.
Okay.
It seems like an obvious thing, but if you think about it, a lot of the things you think, even about yourself, have come from someone else. There's a lot of people who think they're terrible at maths, but if you interrogate that, you'll find that it's because some teacher somewhere in P4 told you you don't have a head for mathematics, and that became your reality.
Yeah.
And it happens with so many other things in our lives. There are messages, you know, being spoken to us everywhere. Some of us don't think that we can ever do certain things because of where we're born, because of our circumstances, because of the way we look, because of all these barriers that life seems to say, this is your place, this is where you belong. But freeing your mind, again, this is why I say battles are won and lost in your mind, freeing your mind, you can never go anywhere that your mind hasn't gone before.
Mm-hmm.
And so if your thoughts are constrained, if they're hampered, it means that your entire life, your entire being, and your future are actually constrained as well.
Mm-hmm.
You can rise above what others think of you, but you can never rise above what you think of yourself.
Okay. Yeah. All right. That's food for thought.
Yes.
Definitely. Okay. Uh-huh. So after KTN, you then applied for the Komla Dumor Award.
Yes. Yes. While I was still at KTN.
Did someone convince you to do it, or did you just decide to do it on your own?
Someone sent me a link, actually, on Facebook. They tagged me in a link.
Uh-huh.
it's pretty random. This is like a week to the deadline. Mm-hmm. They tagged me in a link on Facebook. And I looked at it and thought, I don't think I qualify. So I didn't think about it again.
Mm-hmm.
But then it kept bothering me.
Mm-hmm.
And I literally woke up, I think, the night before the deadline and filled in the application.
Wow.
Yeah, because it just kept bothering me. And I thought, you know what, I'm just going to do it. I'm just going to try it. So I filled it in. And when they called me back and told me, you've gone through the first round, I actually called my sister and said, yes, success. Can you believe it? I've gone through. Oh, we can celebrate. That's all I needed.
Mm-hmm.
And I thought I was done.
Okay.
But then I went through another round and another round. And eventually they called and said I'd won.
Out of about 200 applicants.
Yes, out of, you know, from all over Africa, which to me was incredible. But again, it was just, I think, another example of how much we underestimate ourselves, mm-hmm. especially as women, I think.
Yes.
we always... not always, but it's too easy for us to take a back seat and think we're not good enough.
Yes.
And, yeah.
Mm-hmm. That's true. Mm. So how was that? Was it life changing? I think so.
It was. It certainly was. And again, in many ways, I think it was just being given this space where you can you can come up with ideas, you can innovate, you can really shine, so to speak. The 3 months that I was there, I had a very concerted plan about what I wanted to get out of it, and so I was meeting different people, trying different things, sitting in on different programs, just taking advantage of it as much as I could.
Mm-hmm.
And it was amazing. It was fantastic. I met so many people. I was invited to different conferences because of an article that I wrote about telling the African story. I was invited mm-hmm. to do a TED talk. So it really just mothballed into something much more amazing than I could ever have predicted.
And then when the 3 months were done, mm-hmm. I mean, you joined the BBC officially.
Actually, no.
Was it a couple of months first?
Mm-hmm. So I went back to KTN mm-hmm. Because that's the plan. Yes. That was the plan.
Just the 3 months.
Just the three
then
months.
And go back.
And then you go back. But yes, I did. I did receive an offer for them afterwards for a full time position,
mm-hmm.
which I then took up sometime in June last year.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
How is it working for the BBC? A lot of people want to know.
It's amazing.
Mm-hmm.
I can honestly say that it's an incredible experience because I think because of the model of the BBC, their obligation is to the taxpayer.
Mm-hmm.
They're not funded by the government. They're not funded by by a private corporate entity.
Mm-hmm.
They're funded by TV licensing, which is in part a taxpayer thing. And I think it's one of the last few places in the world that still has the ability to say we're about being completely impartial,
mm-hmm.
about, you know, taking journalism seriously, you know, as something that should be about truth. And in a world of alternative facts, you know, it's what we need.
Mm-hmm.
And I've never seen such a strong commitment to doing good journalism as I have at the BBC. So
okay.
That makes it incredible.
To do all these different things and to do all of them well, do you have a formula?
Well, I think the formula is just, it's about changing how you see time. And I think for us, time mm-hmm. is something that comes and goes, and we don't necessarily manage it or tell it where to go. And, you know, so sometimes we'll say, yeah, let's see what happens.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's an attitude that robs you of a lot of time.
Mm-hmm.
But if you really sit down and calculate how much time you put into different things. So I just did this exercise where I said, for a week, I'm going to just live my life normally and see where my time goes. And I was shocked at how much time I was spending watching series.
A lot of people can relate.
You know,
mm-hmm.
watching series or even even the bathroom. I find half my life is spent in the bathroom. I mean the shower, not the other.
I thought you meant with a magazine or a good book.
No, no, no. In the shower. Like I spend hours in the shower,
time.
Apparently. Mm-hmm. But then because I knew where my time was going, I was able to prioritize.
Mm.
Okay, I love showers. I love to think in the shower. So that stays.
Mm-hmm.
But I can spend maybe an hour less watching series during the week and read a book that is going to, you know, make me a bit smarter, make me better at my job,
mm-hmm.
Or just allocate time for calling up my family.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes we leave those things to chance and say, when I remember, and we end up losing touch.
Mm.
So I think I just changed my perception about time,
mm-hmm.
because I treat it the way I treat money now.
Mm.
With money, we plan, you know, we know it's a finite resource. So
yes.
We say, I don't have enough money, or I have enough money, or I think when I get money, I'll do this. But we don't say that with time.
Mm.
And yet it is a finite resource. So I just changed my mind and now I start treating my time as money. And I say, do I have enough time for this?
Mm-hmm.
Do I have enough time to, you know, to watch this? Binge watch
a whole season
or sit gossiping with, you know, with some workmates in the lunchroom,
mm-hmm.
in the lunch break room. So I think it just helps you manage a bit better and see where it's going. There actually is a lot of time,
mm-hmm.
but only if you manage it well.
Okay. Well, speaking of time, unfortunately, we're out of
it.
We're out of it. Thank you so much for coming on the show.
It's been a pleasure.
Can I just ask, I mean, along all that juggling,
mm-hmm.
do you have time for dating?
I do. Dating is fun.
Oh.
Yes. So I make time for it. I do have time for dating.
Mm-hmm. Are you seeing someone at the moment?
I am. Yes. Oh. I am dating one person at the moment. Last time I checked, at least.
Okay.
So, yes, I am.
Okay. Yeah. All right. We'll wait to hear more, I guess, when there is more.
Yes, you'll be on a need-to-know basis.
Okay, so I will ask you now for your final song, your final request.
My final song is one that I've been listening to a lot over the past few months. It's from Kirk Franklin. And it talks about needing God in your life right now. Mm-hmm. Why that's important for me at this moment is everything is going so well.
Thanks for coming on the show. Here is your last song. Right. Kirk Franklin, My World Needs You.
Show me your face. Fill up this space. My world needs you right now. My world needs you.